A topic is echo assessment of mitral stenosis. Are you there, Kaustubh? Very happy to see you, Kaustubh.
Good afternoon, sir.
Nice to see your smile.
Nice to see you, sir. Good.
Still, you are in the consultation chamber, I think.
Yeah.
Sunday, take rest, relax. Why you are stretching too much?
Is my screen visible?
Slightly, I think you have to volume increase. Just increase your.
Okay.
Computer audio volume you have to increase. Yes. I think.
Now I am audible.
Audible, but I think it's a low pitch. I think.
Now okay, sir.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. Slightly speak loudly.
Okay, sir. So, is my screen visible now?
Yeah, it's visible. Go to the slide. Show.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we'll discuss about echocardiographic evaluation of the mitral stenosis, which is the most common valvular lesion which we come across in day-to-day practice. So we all should know that mitral wall apparatus is a complex three-dimensional functional unit, which consists of mitral annulus, mitral wall leaflets, caudate tendini, and papillary muscles, and surrounding myocardium. So this all unit is affected, and we should see each and every part of this unit to come to a conclusion while we are doing 2D echo of these patients. So there are multiple causes for mitral stenosis. The most common cause is rheumatic, and second most common cause.
First of all, are you slightly away from computer?
Am I audible now?
Yeah, now audible. Now
that I'll keep it like this, then okay.
Yeah. Because
Second most common cause is the stenotic annular calcification. Then other rare causes are congenital inflammatory disease related, that like SLE, infiltrative diseases, carcinoid of the heart disease, and drug-induced valvular disease. These also can cause mitral stenosis. Other rare causes are myxoma, which is causing obstruction of the mitral wall, or the thrombus, which is obstructing the mitral wall. So specific forms of congenital stenosis are parachute mitral wall, supravalvular ring, anomalous mitral arcade, annulus hypoplasia, double orifice mitral wall, and Schoen complex, which consists of LVOT obstruction and congenital mitral stenosis. So most common one, which is the rheumatic mitral stenosis, the hallmark of this mitral stenosis is doming of the anti-mitral leaflet, which is the most important finding, and restriction of the posterior mitral leaflet. So leaflet bulges towards the left ventricle because blood is caught in the leaflets, similar to like boat, which is sailing boat with the wind. And commissural fusion and the restriction of the mitral wall area, opening area is there. And degree of doming not only depends on the severity of mitral stenosis, but also the pliability, that is mobility of the wall. So what we see on clinical examination, that is opening snap, which is heard because of this phenomena, like doming. So plaques view, you have to see for the thickening of the leaflets, doming of the anti-mitral leaflet, and the leaflet thickening will start at the tip of the mitral wall, and posterior mitral leaflet will become restricted in its mobility. And as the disease progresses, there will be involvement of the caudate tendon. In normal length is 10 millimeter. With the disease progression, the caudate will become more shortened, and there will be the fusion of the caudate or long term as disease progresses. And the wall will become more funicular once the disease is in advanced stage. So fibrosis, thickening, calcification of the wall is the seen in progression of this disease process. So here you can see the normal mitral wall and the abnormal mitral wall in the mitral stenosis, where there is thickening of the mitral leaflet, doming of the anti-mitral leaflet, and restriction of the movement of the posterior mitral leaflet. Also, you can see the subvolvular involvement in this view with the thickening of the caudate. This is another view, that is PSACS, in which you have to be perpendicular to the mitral wall to have better view. This view definitely will take more time to achieve for a beginner, and it will need more practice. Once you are able to get this view properly, you can have planimetric measurement of the mitral wall area in this view. You can see medial and lateral commissure. Here the lateral commissure is fused, medial commissure is free of disease, and there is thickening of the tip of the mitral wall. Now this is the apical four chamber view, where you can clearly see the thickening of the tips of the anterior and as well as posterior mitral leaflet and caudate tendon. Also, you have to see for the other factors, especially you have to see for the dilated LA, dilated RA, and RV, pulmonary hypertension. These are the additional findings which you will commonly see in mitral stenosis. Two-chamber view is also important to see the subvolvular apparatus.
There is some mute all other computers except all other mics except speaker. Just take care of Jignesh.
Yeah. So color Doppler across the mitral wall is very important. You should see the escalation pattern in the forward flow, and there will be turbulence in severe mitral stenosis. You also have to see the regurgitant jet in these patients, because almost 40% of mitral stenosis patient will have associated mitral regurgitation. You also have to see the cause of mitral regurgitation, whether it is commissural MR or free MR. That way, it will be beneficial in decision making for the further treatment of that patient. Now here you can see there is LA volume is increased, dilated LA, 20 to 60 ml is the normal volume of the LA. LA appendage has to be seen. I know that is difficult to see the LA appendage in transthoracic echocardiography, but you can still have some idea about LA appendage in parasternal basal short axis and two chamber view. And you have to see for the sac in LA and as well as LA appendage and thrombus in the LA appendage. Also, sometimes you can see large thrombus in LA as well. So dilated RA and RV can also be seen, and paradoxical septal motion can be seen in severe form of mitral stenosis. So how you are going to assess severity of mitral stenosis? First of all, you will do the M-mode echo, 2D echo. In 2D echo, you can do planimetry and Doppler assessment of the severity, like pressure gradients, mitral wall area by pressure half time. Other methods like continuity equation, PISA, and mitral wall resistance are less commonly used, but these are also options. And you have to come to a conclusion, not just depending on the assessment, but also the clinical assessment of the patient and whole collective picture of these M-mode, 2D echo, and Doppler finding will help you to come to a conclusion whether how is the severity of wall involvement. So first of all, M-mode echo, where there is anterior motion of the posterior leaflet in diastole, is seen there because of the restriction of the PML. There is decreased rate of diastolic closing of the AML that will lead to decrease in the EF slope. In severe disease, there will be loss of A wave as well. And A wave can be lost because of atrial fibrillation, or in case of progressive disease, it will be lost. Maintenance of fixed relation of the two leaflets throughout the diastole will give clue regarding the diagnosis. You can also see thickening and calcification on your M-mode, and enlargement of the LA will be seen. So here there is this mitral stenosis M-mode pattern, where you can see this EF slope, which is reduced, and there is the PML restriction is also there. So there will be, normally PML should move in the opposite direction, but in mitral stenosis, the PML move in the direction of the AML. One more view is there. There it is clear, where you can see the PML is moving in the same direction of the AML. So mitral M mode, anterior motion of the PML is diagnostic for mitral stenosis, but sometimes it can be absent also, like 18% of patients where this PML is pliable and it might be doming. Decrease in EF slope is affected by many criteria, like mitral orifice size, severity of fibrosis, calcification of the leaflet, LV compliance, filling pattern, heart rate, diastolic motion of the mitral annulus, all these will affect EF slope. Then that's why it is not diagnostic. It is just an additional finding. It will not correlate with the severity of stenosis. Absence of AVL with or without atrial fibrillation can also be seen, and it will correlate with the severity of the mitral stenosis in absence of atrial fibrillation. So this is the M-mode finding. And if the EF slope is more than 80 mm per second, then mitral wall area will be in the normal range, that 4 to 6 cm square. If it is less than 15 mm per second, then mitral wall area will be less than 1.3 cm square. So here you can see the diastolic movement of the IVS, which is suggestive of severe form of the disease, and the PML also is moving in the same direction of the AML. So planimetry, it correlates.
Also, keep it nearer.
Planimetry.
Because we are recording this one, keep it nearer.
Okay, sir. Planimetry is the best correlation with the anatomical area of the wall, and this, you should scan it properly and avoid overestimation in this area. You should have this measurement in early diastole, and leaflet tips should be perpendicular to the plane of mitral orifice, so as to get a proper view of this mitral wall in this Sachs view. And it should show the elliptical shape of the wall, and direct measurement of orifice can be done. And you can see here the opening of the medial and lateral commissures, whether it is affected or not, how much calcium is there in the commissures, that also you can assess in this view. Excessive gain, if you keep while measuring planimetry, it will underestimate the lesion, and you should zoom and do harmonic imaging to have a better view. Spend optimum time for getting this view and measure it in early to mid diastole. Multiple measurements are required, especially when patient is having atrial fibrillation or incomplete commissural fusion. Difficulty will be seen in some patient who had heavily calcified wall or chest wall deformity. Planimetry is especially difficult in patients who have mitral annular calcification. So gradients, now you have to see with the Bernoulli equation, you can calculate gradients in the mitral wall by formula 4V square. You have to trace the gradient. The color, you can see the nice spectral Doppler pattern here. This nice spectral Doppler pattern will be achieved only when you are keeping your continuous wave Doppler very parallel to the jet of the mitral wall flow. Otherwise, you will not get a good image. So it has to be done in apical four-chamber view, and pulse wave Doppler will not come correct in these patients because their velocity across the mitral wall is more than 1.5 meter per second. You have to do it in continuous wave Doppler, and always see the color Doppler jet before putting this, before seeing this continuous wave Doppler, so that you will get the correct idea. Mild gradient is less than 5, moderate gradient is 5 to 10, and mean gradient of more than 10 is severe mitral stenosis. Now, maximum gradient is also influenced by LA compliance and LV diastolic function. That's why it will not always correlate with the severity. There are other factors also like heart rate, cardiac output, associated MR, which will also affect mitral wall gradient. Tachycardia will increase cardiac output and will also overestimate the gradient. That too same will be seen with the mitral regurgitation. In AF patient, you have to be very careful and try to take at least 4 to 5 cycles and have the average them and then come to a conclusion. Always take the longer cycle instead of shorter cycles. Longer cycle will give you better idea of the gradients. Here, mitral wall area also can be calculated by pressure half time. Normally, there is no gradient between LA and LV. So, once there is mitral stenosis, LA and LV, there will be gradient. Here you can see in like a box where the you are measuring time of pressure to fall to its half of original peak value, that will give you the pressure half time, and it is calculated on this slope. This is the deceleration slope. It is nothing but the EF slope as we seen in the M mode. On that basis, machine will directly calculate using this formula, mitral wall area. So mitral wall area is equal to 220 divided by pressure half time. So mitral wall area is inversely proportional to pressure half time. And also you can calculate via other formulas like 0.29 into deceleration time or 750 divided by deceleration time. So tracing of the deceleration slope of E wave on spectral Doppler pattern is very important, because mistakes in doing this will give incorrect value of the pressure half time. So now here you can see the irregular flow pattern. It is the patient of AF. You have to do multiple readings and come to conclusion. You have to average 4 to 5 readings. Then deceleration slope is sometimes bimodal also. And in that scenario, how you should take the measurement? You have to see here, initial deceleration is very quick and later there is plateau. So you have to avoid calculation in this proximal area. This mid area, you should do measurement for pressure half time. That will give correct value. Then some rare patient will have concave shape of the tracing, that is T half measurement may not be feasible in these patients. So this is important. Factors, there are many factors which will affect pressure half time by influencing LA pressure. So more rapid LA pressure decline will shorten the pressure half time. LA draining to second chamber, like if there is additional ASD, it will rapidly decrease the pressure half time. So stiff LA, that is low compliance of the left atrium, LA pressure will drop rapidly and pressure half time will shorten. Once pressure half time is shortened, what will happen? Wall area will be overestimated. Factors affected by pressure half time influencing the LV pressure. So LV also plays important role for measurement of pressure half time. If LV filling from the second source is there, like if there is additional aortic regurgitation, the LV pressure will rise rapidly and it will shorten the pressure half time. Whereas if LV is stiff, that is low ventricular compliance is there, in that situation also pressure half time will be shortened, because LV pressure will rise suddenly with even small amount of blood. So all factors which affect pressure half time, like ASD, aortic regurgitation, low LA or LV compliance, that will shorten the pressure half time and it will normally overestimate the wall area. Most of the time pressure half time will not underestimate the wall area, except in one condition, that is post balloon mitral valvotomy, where it will underestimate mitral wall area if you calculate immediately after PBMV. If pressure half time is more than 220 milliseconds, then it signifies that severe MS is there. If pressure half time is less than 220, then under that situation, you use other method to assess the severity. When gradient and compliance are subject to important and abrupt changes, there will be change in the pressure half time. This happens especially in the post balloon mitral commissurotomy. There will be discrepancy between the mitral gradient and the increase in net compliance of the left ventricle. Another is the continuity equation, where you will have the mitral stroke volume. It is based on the principle that mitral stroke volume will be same as aortic stroke volume. So mitral wall area multiplied by mitral VTI is equal to LVOT diameter into LVOT VTI. On that basis also you can calculate mitral wall area. This continuity equation is not very commonly used in our day-to-day practice. PISA also is not commonly used in day-to-day practice, because PISA is basically based on the hypothetical formulation that whatever the convergence of diastolic mitral flow is there, it will form the hemispherical shape. But most of the time this hemispherical shape is not hemisphere. So most of the times reading will not be correct with the PISA. There is another method, that is mitral leaflet separation index, which is the distance between the tips of the mitral leaflet. This is semi-quantitative method, and wall area of value of less than 1.2 centimeter, a value of more than 1.2 centimeter is non-severe MS, whereas value of less than 0.8 centimeter is severe mitral stenosis. Not accurate in patients who have heavily calcified walls and post-PBME patients. Here you can see the calculation at the tip level. You also need to quantitate the pulmonary artery hypertension in these patients, and it will also help you in defining the severity. You will also see the dilated pulmonary veins, that also you need to see. Stress echocardiography still has role in mitral wall stenosis. It can unmask symptoms in mitral wall area, when mitral wall area is less than 1.5 centimeter, and there are no doubt or doubtful complaints to the patient. Sometimes patient comes and says he doesn't have any symptoms, but when you do stress echo, you will understand there is unmasking of the symptoms. There will be discrepancy between the resting Doppler and clinical findings. Then there is one method like semi-supine echocardiography, where you will do 30 to 60 seconds of leg rising. It is preferred over post-exercise echocardiography, and it will show the gradient increase. It allows monitoring of the gradient and pulmonary pressure in each step of the increasing workload. So mean mitral gradient and PS systolic pressure to be assessed during exercise. Mean gradient of more than 15 millimeters of mercury with exercise is considered as severe MS, whereas PS systolic pressure of more than 60 millimeters of mercury on exercise is indication for PBMB. And dobutamine stress echo mean gradient of more than 80 millimeters of mercury with stress is considered severe MS, but it is less physiological. Look for associated lesions, like quantitate the LA size, then associated MR and its mechanism has to be seen. Assess for the aortic wall, pulmonary wall, tricuspid wall is commonly affected and neglected in these patients, and you should look for the TR and tricuspid stenosis also in patients with mitral stenosis, and also look for the pulmonary hypertension. Mitral stenosis, you should never miss the thrombus. Incidence of thrombus is quite common in these patients. Almost 10 to 20% incidence is there. And systemic embolism occurs in up to 20% of the MS patients. 80% of these patients will have thrombi because of atrial fibrillation. Excellent candidate for BMV. In this, we'll see four things. One is the mobility of wall, thickening of the wall, calcification of the wall, and subvolvular involvement. Based on each, will get 1 to 4 points. So maximum score can be 8 and minimum 16, and the minimum score will be 4. So mobility, highly mobile wall, we'll carry one point. Only tips are involved. Leaflets, mid and base portion have normal mobility. Then it is grade 2. Wall continues to move forward in diastole, mainly from the base. That means leaflet are not moving, but base is moving. Then it is further restriction, that is grade 3. And no or minimal forward movement of the wall is grade 4. Thickening, normal thickness of the wall is 4 to 5 millimeter. If mid leaflets are normal, considering thickening of the margin up to 5 to 8 millimeter, that is grade 2. If the entire leaflet is thickened up to 5 to 8 mm, then it is grade 3. And if more than 8 to 10 millimeter thickness of entire leaflet, then it is grade 4. Calcification, you will see like single area of hyper intensity on echo, like bright spot, and scattered area of brightness is grade 2. Brightness extending into the mid portion of the leaflet. If there is more extension, then it is grade 3. And extensive brightness throughout the leaflet tissue is grade 4. Subvolvular thickening. This is very important while selection of the patient. Minimal thickening of just below the mitral leaflet is grade 1.
Sorry, Kaustubh, it's away. Actually, voice is very low.
Okay.
Yeah, now that's better. Keep it like
that. Yeah, thickening of the caudal structures extending to 1/3 of the caudal length is grade 2. And thickening extending to distal 1/3 of the cords is grade 3. And extensive thickening and shortening of all caudal structures down to the papillary muscle is grade 4. So this grade 4 subvolvular thickening better to avoid as a PBMB patient. So this is a pictorial representation of what we have discussed just now. Here you can see the mobility, thickening, caudal involvement and calcification. And depending on, you should score the patient and decide what best treatment you can offer for that patient. What are the limitations of Wilkins score? Basically, it is not looking for the nodular fibrosis. We cannot differentiate between fibrosis and calcification. Commissure involvement is not included as a criteria in Wilkins score. That another thing which is the most important thing that you should always look in addition to calculation of the Wilkins score. And it doesn't account for uneven distribution of the pathological abnormalities. And it frequently underestimates the subvolvular disease. There is another score, that is Cormier score, which is not very commonly used, where it is differentiated into three groups depending on the pliability of the wall, calcification, and the subvolvular disease. If subvolvular involvement thickened cord is less than 10 millimeters long, then it comes to group 2, and calcification of the mitral wall extends and there is additional subvolvular apparatus involvement, then it is group 3. So guiding the procedure and detecting acute complication during PBMV is most important, where echo will help you, especially during transseptal puncture, atrial and or ventricular perforation, tamponade can be easily seen. And acute mitral regurgitation, wall disruption also can be seen in these patients. So evaluation and short and long-term results of the intervention are done with the echo, where planimetry is ideal. Pressure half-time should not be used immediately after PBMV. Long-term, you can use pressure half-time as well as planimetry for evaluation of restenosis of the wall. So this is normal grading of the severity of mitral stenosis, where mild is wall area of more than 1.5, moderate is 1 to 1.5, and severe is less than 1. So recently, newer criteria says 1 to 1.5 as a severe mitral stenosis, according to new ESC guideline. And you can also do PBMV if patient are very symptomatic and their wall area is between 1 to 1.5. So this is additional new in the ESC guideline and AHA guideline as well. And mean gradient, if mild, less than 5, 5 to 10 is moderate, more than 10 is severe. Pulmonary artery systolic pressure of less than 30 millimeters of mercury is mild, 30 to 50 is moderate, and more than 50 is severe. In prosthetic mitral wall stenosis, detection of mitral stenosis, especially in the situation of prosthesis, is difficult. Here you can use pressure half-time, And you also should rely on the previous gradients. If you have previous gradients of the prosthetic wall, that will be more beneficial. If you want to come to conclusion, expected normal half time is longer than native wall and varies with type and size of the wall. Bioprosthetic wall and for mechanical walls, the pressure half time will give reasonable approximation. You can also use continuity equation in these patients, and pressure gradient can also be used with gradients varying with the type and size of the wall. So here are a few MCQs, and normal mitral wall area is 4 to 6 cm². Normal mitral leaflet thickness is 4 to 5 mm. Mitral wall area is calculated with pressure half time. B option is correct, 220 by pressure half time. Maximum Wilkins score is 16. As a beginner, which score you will choose to do your first PVMV case is 8 and below. So we should always choose these patients. Which is the most reliable method for calculation of mitral wall area, out of which the planimetry is the best? And PH, all are correct except for pressure half time. That PHT is not a reliable calculation for wall area after PBMV. So this is not correct. EF slope, all is correct except that it is affected by mitral wall orifice area. It is accurate method of quantitation of severity of MS. We all know that it is not accurate method for calculation of the severity. Then all are true in stress echo for mitral stenosis. Mean gradient of more than 18 millimeters of mercury with exercise is considered as severe MS. So for exercise, you need 15 millimeters of mercury. And severe MS is wall area of less than 1 cm². Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Kausub, for excellent talk. Very beautiful slides illustrating all important aspects of echo assessment of mitral valve disease. And Dr. Shailendra Singh, are you there? Yes, sir, final few words. Now we have a last talk.
Very exhaustive review of echocardiography in mitral stenosis. Very good. And you just emphasized on the importance of Wilkins scoring. That is very important even today. Unfortunately, Aarogyashri has killed mitral balloon valvuloplasty, but otherwise, mitral valvuloplasty is a very good treatment for mitral stenosis. I still have patients over 20 years after PBMV doing well.
Yes, sir.
I think because the low cost, nobody is indulging in doing mitral stenosis under scheme, because even management is also not in, hardly 20,000.
Not
really, very, very. And that is a very highly skilled procedure. But it needs a lot of talent also. Puncturing, entering balloons also. But at least they should have given 40,000 to 50,000. Yeah, then we will move on to the next topic. Dr. Lokesh, are you there?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Lokesh is very, very close friend of mine. Of course, he's very young, but he has been assessed with me for 2 years. And actually, when he told me one day, I'm going to leave, sir, means really I was shocked. Without Lokesh, I'm going to work. Everybody was wondering. And really, I was very impressed with the way you examined the patients. Yeah. Your academic skills are really, really very good. I think we have a very bright future, and all of you, see, all my associates, because you people are very nice people with beautiful personalities, the relationship with the patients very good, and with a highly academic, that is very important. See, updating is very, very important. Over to you, Lokesh.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Salin, sir, and everybody. So.